Pierce, it seemed like what Duvall had to work his way through was just a whole collage of immunity-type laws, where the Army Corps has immunity under, for example, the 1928 Act of Corps immunity for damages that came out of flood protection, where
right.
they talked about breaches. But there were other smaller kinds of immunity problems that he also had to work through. So most of what and by the way, let me disclose, my law firm worked on this case as well, and I have to say that because I want all the facts to be out on the table. But my memory of this was when Matt Schultz was working on this case with you, that it was almost an endless stream of pleadings coming from the government, immunity this, immunity that, immunity this, every other line. And so how do you feel about, first of all, how do you feel about the concept of immunity to begin with when you have conduct this outrageous by the Army Corps? And secondly, did the judge work his way through it?
He worked his way through it brilliantly. I'll get to that in a moment. And immunity for your listeners who aren't trialers like you and Mike is, despite any determination by a judge or a jury that someone was negligent, that is their standard of, they breached the standard of care, doctor, engineer, lawyer, accountant, the law says you can't be held liable. Immunities are frowned upon. They're undemocratic. And the Army Corps of Engineers enjoys two immunities. One is if they build flood walls and it fails, as you said under the 28 Act, they get a pass. And secondly, if they can persuade a court that they've been exercising policy, economic, political, or social choices, they get a pass. Now, the problem with an immunity is it's a perverse incentive. There's no incentive if you can't be held for money damages, which is about the only thing, as you and I know, that gets corporations and government agencies to change their behavior. If you can't be held liable, you really have what the judge called an insouciance, which is a French word for don't give a damn. Mm-hmm. And the problem we have here is if a civil engineer, a civilian civil engineer, had done what was done here, we'd bankrupt them because they deserve to be hit with both not only compensatory but punitive damages. One of the things we're seeking in our settlement package is Congress to wake up and realize that you've got to reform the Corps and you've got to take away these immunities. Certainly if there's a finding of gross negligence, monumental negligence, which Judge Duvall found here, you certainly should be stripped of your immunity.
One thing we're seeing now is all the regular Republican right-wing suspects in Congress and all the, you know, the policy wogs and talking heads are saying, you know, gee whiz, maybe we should have paid attention to what was going on down there. Let's handle this another way. Now, what's interesting about that is they didn't want to handle anything. They didn't want to do anything until this verdict came out, and now they're all rushing in to say, well, gee, let's do something, and let's ignore this verdict. Had it not been for this verdict, these people would still be handled the same way that Barbara Bush and George Bush and Michael Brown handled them from the word go, as if they're unimportant to what American structure is all about. So I think that's interesting. I think that now you have this rush to come in and say, oh, well, you know, maybe we were wrong. Maybe we should give them money, but let's ignore this lawsuit. Let's do away with this lawsuit and treat it another way. You seeing that kind of develop?
Well, you know, some of the blogosphere are saying that. But right now, actually, Governor Jindal, who's a conservative Republican, David Vitter, conservative Republican up for reelection, certainly Mary Landrieu, Congressman Charlie Melanson, Mayor Nagin have all come out saying you must settle with these people. So at least the local politicians are really being in where they ought to be, supporting the people. We waged a lonely battle, as you know, Mike. It was 4 years. The lawyers, 20 of the top law firms in the country, banded together.
Huge money that all of us spent, huge effort.
$8 million of cost just out of our pocket, and probably $30 million at least in legal time by the 20 firms.
Yeah.
And, you know, this is not a get-rich-quick scheme for plaintiffs' lawyers. We may never see the money. It's not going to change our lifestyle. And I really am proud of the trial bar stepping up here because we spoke truth to power. And this verdict will be in the law books forever. And we're not going to let them ignore it. And frankly, we're not going to let the Obama administration ignore it. And the first sign that they want business, they don't want business as usual, is to not pursue an appeal and sit down with us and negotiate a global settlement. Yeah. We need to restore the wetlands. We need to rebuild the infrastructure and compensate people fairly.
Yeah, we'll see. You know, as you may or may not know, I've been critical of Obama and what change has really meant to Obama. What in the hell does change mean when he says change, when he said change during his campaign? And I haven't seen that really in place like it should be. So I'm hoping that when he says change, that he understands that some of that has to do with we need to change the way that we treat people, the kind of the have-nots of our society. And that is what happened down in New Orleans. We ignored them because they weren't members of the country club.
Well, that's right. And I think that I'm going to give the president and Eric Holder the benefit of the doubt for a short time here. We're trying to get meetings with the key policy decision makers. I mean, the people litigate these cases for the Corps, and the Corps itself have issued defiant statements. We're going to take you to the Supreme Court. Well, that's business as usual. As you said, that's not change.
There's no change. Yeah, exactly.
Let's see what happens, Mike. Let's see what happens in the next 90 days.
I'm optimistic only to the fact that this judge, Duvall, is brilliant. I mean, Stanford Duvall is brilliant.
Yep.
And when you read this decision, you see how troubled he was. As a matter of fact, I looked at Oliver Hoke, who's a law professor at Tulane, and when he reviewed Duvall's decision, and the thing he pointed out was the same thing I saw, that it's packed with technical details trying to say, look, you have to understand why I did this, Fifth Circuit. You have to look at what happened here to understand how ugly this whole travesty is. And before you decide to reverse me, basically, you must look at the charts, you must review this testimony, and you'll be as outraged as I am. Basically, that is kind of what Hawk was saying when he took a look at that decision.
Well, Oliver Hawk was Environmental Lawyer of the Year,
yeah,
and he's one of the most distinguished law professors in the country, and I respect him immensely. Judge Duvall wrote an opinion that I view as factually impregnable because he sat through a four-week trial. He read every deposition. He read 5,000 pages of expert reports. He reread the transcript twice, okay? And you can't go for a paragraph without seeing a citation to the record. Now, what that means to our listeners is he documented his statements with facts that the government cannot assail.
Yeah, and Hawk's point was, you know, of course this is a terrible embarrassment to the Army Corps. I mean, but I disagree with him to this degree. It was almost like this is their first big blot. This is not the first big blot.
First time they got caught.
Yeah, this is the first time they got caught. That's exactly what I was going to say.
I'm sorry.
And so the point being, maybe this is a little bit of a wake-up call, but my biggest disappointment will be if, you know, we heard the term change in the campaign. Now, if that doesn't match what we see right here, Eric Holder, you have to consider. I mean, look at the firm he came from, you know, big defense firm, Burlington Covington. I mean, they're just massive defense firm. And I just hope he doesn't carry that defense mentality into this process as he looks at what happened down in New Orleans.
If the bureaucracy, the mid-management lawyers have their way, they'll try to talk him out of the right thing. That's why the political pressure, coupled with the legal pressure of our victory, is really what we need here. And it's a very unique situation. This is the largest disaster in American history. As we proved, Mike, in the courtroom, and the judge said, it wasn't a natural disaster. It was a man-made disaster by the Army Corps of Engineers. And if we live in a true democracy, and if it means anything to say government of, by, and for the people, when the people get injured by their government, the government has to compensate them. That's what the Federal Tort Claim Act was supposed to be all about. It's riddled with these immunities, and we've got to do something about it. But the first order of business is we got to rebuild New Orleans.
Yeah, and it's going to take money to do that.
Tell me something I don't know. Cause we've been at some times before.